And during the next 34 minutes and 48 seconds, I am going to try and cover the burden of reflux mechanisms as well as physiology, diagnostic considerations, what, when, and how, treatment options, which I'm going to review very briefly only because I think it's relevant towards the underlying physiology, and then I'm going to end with a case from my own clinic. So if you think of reflux symptoms, 20% of U.S. adults will have symptoms at least once a week, 60% at least once a year. This is directly linked to obesity. And if you look at the cost of PPI use alone within the U.S. at present, it's greater than $14 billion. This is a map of the states, which I'm sure you've seen in countless talks throughout the past few years, but it's coded based on body mass. And what I want you to see is in 1990, there was no state in the entire country that had a rate of obesity of 15% or greater. And then just watch as I scroll through the next 25 years. And you can see that we as a country are getting heavier and heavier and heavier. Now, 2010, just 20 years later than that first map which I showed, we now don't have a single state in the entire country that has a rate of obesity of less than 20. In 2015, which is the most recent map that I have, they had to change the whole color code system because we've just grown that much larger. So not surprisingly, reflux has also increased in that time frame as well. In addition to symptoms, we also see esophagitis, hemorrhage, stricture, Barrett's esophagus. Adenocarcinoma is now the eighth leading cause of cancer death in the states, as well as the fastest growing cancer in Caucasian men past the age of 50. And if you think of the patients we see, most patients with reflux do respond to PPI therapy, but approximately 10 to 40% still have symptoms despite standard dose. And given the large number of patients that we're seeing now, as well as the fact that you can get a PPI from the drugstore present without a prescription, the vast majority of the patients that we see in clinic are currently people who are symptomatic despite therapy. Granted, I have a somewhat biased referral population, but I can't tell you the last time that I've seen a patient coming in with reflux symptoms who hasn't attempted a PPI before. And if you think of reflux, this is a normal process. So if we didn't reflux at all, we'd have bloating, distension, we'd feel miserable. This is a normal gas vent response. The average person will have acid in the esophagus less than 4% of the time throughout a day, and will have less than 40 episodes during the course of the day. But it is appropriate to have some. And if you think of the various defense mechanisms we have in play, we have a fair amount of them with a decent amount of redundancy. So we have the lower esophageal sphincter, we have fundic compliance, we have a diaphragm that augments that sphincter, we have secondary peristalsis, so if you do reflux, it should get pushed down and clear. We have about a liter a day of saliva that buffers anything that comes up. The average person will swallow 600 times a day, and then if there is acid that gets in the esophagus, there's also as well an epithelial barrier function with it. So why do patients get symptoms of GERD? And if you step back, there's a lot of reasons besides just higher amounts of acid. And so they could have a possible gastric cause, which could be obesity with higher gastric pressures. They could have reduced fundic compliance. They could have problems with the junction itself, which could include disruption with a hernia, a hypotensive sphincter, or increased transient lower esophageal sphincter relaxation episodes. They could have problems with motility in the esophagus, such that they aren't clearing what comes up. They could have impaired barrier function. They could have a change in saliva, or they could have increased sensation of these episodes. So if you're seeing someone who comes in and they have symptoms of reflux despite a PPI, then your first step, you can break them into a couple different buckets. So they could have continued acid production despite the meds that they're on, which could be improper dosing, non-compliance, nocturnal acid breakthrough, reduced bioavailability, difference within metabolism, H. pylori status. They could have PPI resistance, delayed healing, or else continued acid despite none of the above. They could have non-acid reflux, which is somewhat confusingly defined as being a pH of greater than 4. They could have an alternative cause besides GERD, or this could be something that falls in the functional bucket. So to switch towards diagnostics, I'd like to go through these four questions. And the first one, which I'll address, is what tests are currently available to look at GERD? And if you step back and look at how we can make the diagnosis, there isn't one test that everyone falls into. And usually we'll make this diagnosis through a pattern of these entities which are listed. So if you consider that acid induces these symptoms within the vast majority of people, it would make sense that empiric acid suppression could be used as both a diagnosis as well as a therapy. This has been looked at in multiple different studies. It has reasonably good sensitivity, but specificity is only about 50%. But it makes sense to start with this if there's no red flags, with the idea that we look at a very large patient population, and going and doing endoscopy on 20% of America seems like it might be too much. And second, this is cost savings as well. So what do you do if the PPI test fails? And I've put down barium, but I'll say that barium, I think, is really a third or fourth line test at this point. And barium studies are good at looking at hernias or L strictures, but they're not very good at looking at reflux per se. And the reason for that is that if the average personal reflux about 40 times a day, then catching one or two episodes of reflux with a barium study doesn't necessarily define a higher or lower amount. And conversely, if you don't see any episodes during the course of spot films, that doesn't mean that they don't go out and have a large meal and then have 70 events afterwards. But where it can be helpful is if you are looking at strictures or also hernia. Typically, if there are symptoms despite a PPI trial, the next step is typically endoscopy. And this is important to exclude other factors that could mimic, such as EoE, as well as to look at complications such as Barrett's or also esophagitis. But it's important to know going into this test that your sensitivity for establishing a diagnosis of reflux with endoscopy is reasonably low. And so within a community practice where patients are off therapy and coming in, the positive yield of doing endoscopy for seeing esophagitis or Barrett's is in most studies between 10 to 20%. But if they take a PPI at the time that you're doing the scope, at that point the yield drops. And there have been studies that show that if you look at non-cardiac chest pain, for instance, the likelihood that you're going to establish a diagnosis of reflux in that case is about 6%. So while we do endoscopy, it's important to know going into it that most times that's going to come back looking normal. I've put one slide of capsule endoscopy, and I'll say up front that I don't think this is ready for prime time yet, but I think it's important to talk about for two reasons. The first is patients ask about it. The second is that I think the field could change, and this might be something more relevant in 15 or 20 years. Right now, esophageal capsule endoscopy is about 60 to 70% as sensitive as doing endoscopy. And given that I've already said that the sensitivity of endoscopy is about 10 to 20%, that makes this much less so. But I think if we look 15 years into the future, if the cost of these dropped to, let's say, $10 a capsule, and you had a joystick that could move this back and forth and take biopsies selectively, then perhaps the field will change. Most times, if you have a patient who has symptoms despite a PPI, and you look with endoscopy and you don't find anything conclusive, then your next step has typically been some pH monitoring if additional workup is warranted. And this has been in use at present since the late 1970s. It does allow you to look at both acid exposure as well as correlation between symptoms and acid. If you look at this study in a patient who is on once daily PPI and symptomatic, you will find acid in about 1/3 of patients, typically at night. But if they're on a PPI twice a day, the rate of a positive study at that point drops to between 4 to 7%. During the last 15 years, and this is me in 2006 when I had hair getting one of these studies. So in the past 15 years, we've seen two changes. The first one is wireless pH monitoring. And the concept here is that you place a catheter, which can be done during endoscopy or else separate, which is applied towards the wall of the esophagus, is then suctioned and kept in place. Usually will stay in place for about 7 to 10 days. It records the pH of that site every 6 seconds, telemetrically sends it to a separate recorder, and you can get between 2 to 4 days of information from that. And what you get is something like this, where it's possible to look at acid exposure during that time period, separate meals and non-meal periods, separate supine and upright, and then look to see what happens when there are symptoms. Main benefit of this is that you can combine it with endoscopy. There's no need to have a catheter, and it does allow you to look at multiple days. The downside is that you're just looking at acid. You have to make the choice of if you're going to test on or off therapy. It's more expensive, and it's not as widely available. Traditionally, if there's symptoms despite PPI use and you're comfortable that acid has been suppressed, the next step is to look at non-acid reflux. And at present, the test that we have that allows us to do that is pH impedance. The concept here is that impedance is opposition to current within a closed circuit. So if you take two rings and you apply a small amount of voltage across it, whatever is outside those rings will close that circuit. And so you can separate the components against the rings based on conductive properties in that scenario. And things that conduct well, such as fluid, will cause impedance to drop. Things that conduct poorly, such as air, will cause it to rise. And if you take a catheter and you place these rings across the whole catheter, it's possible to monitor reflux going up, how high it's going, separate air and fluid, as well as look at swallows. If you combine that with a pH sensor, then it's possible to separate what's acid and what's non-acid. And this is what it looks like in practice. Blue is the esophagus, white is fluid. The mouth is at the top of your screen, stomach is at the bottom. And you can see here two swallows. Here are two swallows with a reflux event. Here's a reflux event that lasts for about 10 seconds. And here's two reflux events that last in total for about 2 minutes. And you can see if you looked at the red line that goes across the screen, it doesn't appreciably change. So what this means is that this is essentially a non-acid event. And if you were looking at just a pH study, you wouldn't pick it up. Once again, it's a catheter-based study. So which test should you choose? And why? And for the next two questions, I'm going to rely heavily on the Porto consensus that came out within neurogastromotility just recently. And this was a group of 50 experts that got together and tried to make recommendations to standardize the way that GERD is tested. And if you look at the pros and cons of doing wireless pH versus pH impedance, there's really a case to be made for both sides. And I think if you look at wireless, the main benefit you have is that you can combine it with endoscopy. It takes about 2 extra minutes. You don't have to have a catheter. You can look at multiple days. So if you have someone that has bad heartburn, let's say 1 of every 2 or 3 days, You do run the risk that if you do just a 24-hour study, maybe they'll have a great day and you're not quite sure what to make of that. With the wireless probe, because you can extend it for up to four, it gives you more chance to get symptoms. Maybe you get a better representation of what's really going on in that if you have a wireless probe, you could get that probe and then come here and be at the conference and go and run afterwards and get dinner in a restaurant, and you'd feel perfectly fine doing that. But if you have a 24-hour pH impedance catheter, you're probably going to be sitting at home waiting to take it out. And there's been studies that show that if you ask patients who've had both which one they like better, patients prefer the wireless probe. But there are downsides. It doesn't look at non-acid. Because you're only looking at one point in time, it may be hard to separate swallows and reflux events. And if you have someone who sits here and, let's say, sips coffee and doesn't mark it upon the diary, you're not going to have a way of separating that swallow from heartburn. You have to choose if it's on or off therapy. It's more expensive. It's not as widely available. With pH impedance, you get the benefit of looking at both acid and non-acid. You can separate swallows and reflux. You can measure how high the reflux events goes, which may have clinical utility in possible pulmonary issues. You can look at air movement as well as fluid. You don't have to have endoscopy or else sedation. It's cheaper. But the downside is that it does require a 24-hour catheter. You are limited to one day of recording, and the interpretation is more complicated. So if I look at a wireless probe, I feel very comfortable that I can read the whole study in less than a minute. But if I look at pH impedance, I'm often sitting there for between 20 to 40 minutes. So should you test on or off therapy? And this was looked at specifically in the Porto consensus. And what they recommended, which I think is very reasonable, is that if you don't have an established diagnosis of reflux, meaning that you haven't seen severe esophagitis defined as LA grade C or D, Barrett's or L-septic stricture, or you have atypical symptoms, or you're thinking of doing a reflux operation, or you have symptoms after an operation, then it's best to test in that setting off therapy. But if you have a patient who has confirmed reflux but continued symptoms, or they've had a prior positive study, then you're better served testing on. How to interpret the tests. And typically, when you're doing these tests, and once again, I will lean heavily on this paper. There's four things which you look for in a study. The first one is study quality. The second is acid exposure. The third is impedance, if that's applicable. And then the fourth is symptom correlation. And if you look at acid, one of the nice things that I think the consensus added was that in past papers that have looked at acid interpretation, it's often been viewed as binary, meaning that you have a positive test or else a negative. And what that means is that if you set a cutoff, let's say, of 4.1%, then if you had a patient who had 4% acid, you would call that normal. If it was 4.2, it was positive. And in real life, it's probably not that simple. And so what they've recommended is that if you have acid exposure of less than 4, that's normal. If you have acid exposure of greater than 6, that's high. And if it's between 4 to 6, it falls into a borderline zone. With impedance, there's been 4 papers that have attempted to look at the number of reflux events which are normal, and the value that they've reported has ranged from 42 to 75. So what the Porto consensus recommended, very similar to acid, is that if you have less than 40, that's normal. If you have greater than 80, that's high. If it's between the two of them, that's borderline. Symptom correlation, there's 2 commonly used form you lie at present. The first one is symptom index, which is reasonably intuitive, and it's the percent of symptoms that are linked with a reflux event, and greater than 50% is considered to be a positive correlation. And what that means is that if you see someone that has 10 symptoms in the course of 24 hours and 6 of them are linked with acid, then they would have a symptom index at that point is 60%. That's positive. Second one that's been looked at is the SAP, and that's essentially an association probability that looks at the statistical correlation between reflux and symptoms, but doesn't necessarily look at the strength of that correlation. And this is one that's not intuitive, and so you can't just look at it and calculate. You have to have software for it, but it essentially records the inverse of a p-val value, and so less than 0.05 is significant, which corresponds to an SAP of greater than 95%. So in terms of looking at symptoms, you want to look at both of these with the idea that the SAP will say if the link appears to be statistically significant, but the symptom index will show the strength of that correlation. So putting it all together, if you see a patient with reflux and you decide to do testing looking at that, you can break them into a few categories. If you do a test off therapy and you find that they have more acid than what's typical, you can at that point classify them as GERD. If you find that their acid impedance distribution is normal, but they have positive symptom correlation, then they fall into a category of reflux hypersensitivity. And if they don't meet those criteria in terms of symptoms, acid impedance, then the test is normal and there's some additional cause at play. If you test on therapy and they still have acid or high impedance despite therapy, then you can classify them as GERD with persistent issues despite therapy. If you find that after therapy that their reflux burden is normal, but they have a positive symptom correlation, but you're testing on therapy in the case of known GERD, then they would have a combination of GERD as well as reflux hypersensitivity. So what is the role of manometry? And I think this has changed within the past few years. If you think of manometry, it's really not a good test looking at reflux per se, but it does have a key role to play. And where it can be helpful is that it can aid in a landmark placement if you're doing a pH impedance catheter. You can ensure that you're not missing a prominent motility disorder. It allows you to exclude belching and rumination. It also allows you to look specifically at the gastroesophageal junction as well as to give information in terms of peristalsis. And so if you think of stepping back towards mechanisms of reflux and looking at what you get from manometry, you essentially get information about peristalsis, which may be relevant towards secondary peristalsis and clearance, and you get some information about the structure of the GE junction. So if you're doing manometry in someone who has refractory GERD symptoms, the key things that you want to look at are at the junction, is it intact, is there a possible hernia, and what's the pressure of the LES? And then you want to look at the esophageal body and see once again, is that intact or is there any impairment within peristalsis? And then there's also a way to look at contraction reserve, which has been pioneered by the group at WashU. And what they've essentially shown is that if you do rapid water swallows, that you should have an augmented contraction afterwards. And if you don't have that, then you're more likely to get postoperative dysphagia. So in terms of what this looks like in practice, this is what you should see on top in type 1 with a gastroesophageal junction without a hernia. And then type 2 and type 3, you at that point see hernias, which are increasing in size. In terms of peristalsis, what you would want to see is on the left, and then on the right three columns, you see increasing dysmotility. Of note, both the fragmented as well as the ineffective fall into a category of uncertain clinical significance, meaning that while they may be associated with symptoms, they also can be seen in subjects who are healthy without symptoms. And then if you look at rapid water swallows, this is what you should see here in this case, essentially a lack of swallows during these five and then a post-swallow contraction, which is augmented. So I'll jump through this a little bit towards the next slide. So I'm going to briefly talk about the treatment only as it relates towards mechanisms. And If you think of treatment of reflux, these are essentially the options that we have at present. And so first one is lifestyle modification. And I think with all the PPI concerns that have come up within the last few years and recognition that weight is certainly a factor in the increase that we've seen throughout the last 25 years, there's been more of a pendulum shift back towards lifestyle change in the last few years. If you look at this list, it's reasonably long, but if you step back and look at the data that's associated with it, the things that really seem to bear out are weight loss, if that's a factor, raising the head of the bed, usually between 2 to 4 inches at night, if there's acid exposure or symptoms at night, and trying to avoid meals within 3 hours of lying down. The dietary issues, there's a number of trigger foods which are listed, but if you look at the data with regards to improvement in reflux by cutting out these trigger foods, once a symptom pattern has been established, the data with that is pretty poor. And so what I usually tell patients is to try and stay with a healthy diet, focus on low-fat, small-portion meals, and if they see that there's a trigger food that they associate with symptoms, to cut that out. But if they want to have a cup of coffee in the morning and their symptoms are all entirely at night, or if they find that if they take onions, they have absolutely no symptoms whatsoever, then I don't ask them to cut everything from this list out if it doesn't seem clinically relevant. In terms of acid suppression, we have 3 options which are available. The antacids and H2 blockers work much faster and are much cheaper. The PPIs are currently the mainstay of therapy. They are much more expensive. They are much more effective. One thing I do want to draw your attention to here is the onset, though. And if you look at the PPIs, they take a while to take full effect. And so if you have a patient who has symptoms maybe once or twice a week or has triggers that they know, they may do wonderful with doing an H2 blocker. And if you don't take those each day and you don't have tachyphylaxis, they're quite effective in that scenario. Going towards other medical therapy that works through different mechanisms, we have a few options, but these are mostly secondary and complementary. Baclofen has been shown to decrease transient lower esophageal sphincter relaxations, as well as increase lower esophageal sphincter pressure. But it really has, I think, a limited role at present due to the fact that it has tachyphylaxis with it. It's a 3 or 4 time a day drug, and about 40% of those that take it will have some adverse effects with it. Where I tend to use it is if someone has nighttime symptoms, I may do a dose of it right before bedtime. Prokinetics increase gastric emptying and may take away some of the gastric pressure coming back. They also may be a role within esophageal contractions as well, but in general, that benefit's pretty modest. Alginates have, I think, come back to attention within the last few years. And Gaviscon, when it was first formulated, had a seaweed derivative in which formed a raft on top of acid. And so the concept is that you cover the acid pocket and that you essentially don't stop reflux, but you limit the contact between the reflux that comes up with the esophagus. The current Gaviscon that's sold in the U.S. does not contain that formulation anymore, but the ones in South America and Europe do, and it's possible to get this online for as cheap as $8 a packet. There's been about 20 papers that have looked at this within the last 3 years, so it seems like it's coming back. And then occasionally we'll look at bile acid binders. Buspirone has been hypothesized to increase fundic compliance and may have a role here as well. If you step back and look at complementary therapies, there was a nice paper that was from the Foss group in 2007 looking at sessions of acupuncture. Unclear how exactly this worked in terms of mechanism, but it probably decreases visceral sensation. If you look at endoscopic therapies, we have a number of options which are there. I think the role for these is more complementary in highly selected patients in centers with a lot of experience doing this. And we may see more of these in future years, but I think at present the role of these is more limited. The one that's been around at present the longest is Streta, which has currently been FDA approved for about 11 years. The concept of this is to ablate the junction with the idea of decreasing distensibility and potentially impacting sensation as well. I think literature with this has shown symptom improvement, but not necessarily reduction in acid. And then there's been a few variants looking at plication. I think we'll see more of this in years to come. What's out has looked reasonably positive, but small numbers and just in very select sites. And then you can sit back and look at surgery. And we have a few options there. Fundoplication can be tailored to increase a barrier function. The system with trade name Lynx looking at magnets has also been shown to increase a barrier function as well. And the 5-year literature from that looks positive. There is a pivotal trial going on in the U.S. now looking at Endostim, which is a stimulator that's implanted to increase lower esophageal sphincter pressure. And then you could think of gastric bypass as well in those patients who are overweight with the idea of basically reducing gastric pressure, and that seems to work quite well if a BMI is past 35. So I'd like to end with a case from my own clinic. And this is a 46-year-old man who came to see me with chest pain. It had increased within the last year. He said it was 13 of 10 at its worst. Interestingly, it was 3 centimeters to the right of his midline, but it did occur approximately an hour and a half after food and at night, and he felt he had a clear link with pepper as well as garlic. He had no heartburn, dysphagia, no exercise association, no cardiac risk factors, and a negative stress test. I was, I think, the seventh doctor that he'd seen for this, and he'd had a very extensive workup. So he'd had 4 separate endoscopies in the past with biopsies. He had a wireless pH probe on therapy, which was normal with 0.0 percent exposure. He had esophageal manometry, which was normal. He had a technetium HIDA scan that showed a decreased biliary ejection fraction. He then got cholecystectomy, and his symptoms were unchanged. He was seen by ortho, was placed on NSAIDs with the idea of costochondritis, was seen by psychiatry, and had tried 6 separate PPIs without improvement. And when he came to see me, his key question really was that his best friend is in GI. The patient is convinced this is reflux. His friend is convinced this is all anxiety and psychiatric. So who's right? And if you step back and look at this, we sat down and looked at everything he had. And my personal suspicion that he had reflux as a cause of his chest pain was reasonably low, given the testing that he'd had to date. And he had some lifestyle factors that would also point towards anxiety, but could contribute to reflux as well. He had a very high stress job. He had a 9-month-old daughter. He slept about 6 hours a night, and he drank about 5 cups of coffee in the morning. So we sat down and said, well, you know, pre-test suspicion is reasonably low. Let's do a wireless test off therapy and see. So surprisingly, he had 9 percent acid exposure off therapy. He had 28 episodes of chest pain, 24 of them linked with acid. Despite the fact that he told me he never had heartburn ever, he pressed the button 12 times. And so I then went and started him on PPIs twice a day, and his symptoms were unchanged. So what next? So we talked with him at that point about doing pH impedance. He at first was very reluctant because he didn't want to be in meetings with the catheter there, and he didn't want his child pulling upon the catheter. And so he wrestled with the issue, finally decided to go ahead and do it. And we had a technician error, and the study was not downloaded and subsequently erased without any information. So I called him up expecting to be chewed out, and he surprisingly said, you know, it wasn't as bad as I thought. I'll go ahead and do it again. So we, at that point, went ahead and did it, and he had 101 episodes, complete acid suppression, but strong symptom correlation. So what now? And this is someone that we then can step back and say that he has baseline GERD. because when we did test off therapy, it was positive, but he also has reflux hypersensitivity as well. And so what's the best means of going after that? And so in his case, you know, we sat down and talked about options and decided to keep him upon a PPI once a day to start an SNRI. And then we went after lifestyle change very aggressively. And so he cut down his coffee from 5 a day to 1 a day. He tried to sleep an extra hour. He worked on stress reduction, and gradually he did a lot better. And I think in his case, part of it also was knowing that this was genuine and that this wasn't anxiety and psychiatric. That by itself seemed to get him better. So last time that I had talked to him, he was 3 years out and doing really, really well. So take home points. GERD is really a result of multiple mechanisms. It's not just excess acid. Refractory GERD is common and is usually due to factors besides inadequate acid suppression. Evaluation of refractory GERD is aimed at trying to better define the mechanisms at play. And typically, that's looking with endoscopy, doing some sort of testing, looking at reflux itself, whether it be a wireless probe versus a pH impedance, and then if symptoms continue, manometry. And the treatment should then be tailored towards the underlying mechanism, if that's possible. Thank you very much.